Yeah, good.
I don't get to. Alright, I'm gonna bust my battery life halfway. Alright, let's take it home. Where
yeah.
We at? Opportunists or
yeah.
Entrepreneurs? Who's behind this? Alright, give me a clap when you get a chance and then just take it off. Was it on the desk the whole time? Or?
No, it's on the floor.
Alright.
Third go around.
Perfect. Alright, opportunists aren't entrepreneurs. Who's behind this? How did this happen and what is the purpose? Or was it just a lucky accident? Feel good?
Being born in 1956, those were the years where the people such as Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, Wozniak, these is the same. Now, can I do it again? Sorry.
Yeah, hold on. Put my headphones in when yep. I have the opportunity. Alright, from the top.
Being born in the mid-50s, I share a generation with people like Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, Larry Ellison. These are the people who made this new generation of interactive products. These are the people who foresaw the future. I always admired them. Prior to the books I've currently written, I had on deck a book called American Icon. It was the story of Steve Jobs. Not the stories that we always know about in the bio and the biographies and these things, but it was kind of talking about what made him what he is. Many people may not know that he was adopted. His father was a Syrian refugee. There's a big story, I'm not going to go into it now. Anybody can find that anywhere. The interesting part was that they were born in this age of innovation. And the question becomes, were they actually truly entrepreneurs? Were they merely opportunists? Were they both? Now, Woz is different. Wozniak truly appears to be a real humanist, whereas Jobs, Gates, Ellison, this crew, appears to be more of an opportunist. Numerous times, Jobs, as I've said before, used the word seduce. He saw the opportunity. Did he see it in the sense of how far down the road it would go? My belief is yeah. My belief is his early days of eWorld, where Apple got in to the internet space, the social media platform, years before it became popular. I think he knew what was coming. He was always a visionary. Everybody hates that word with him, but he was absolutely brilliant. Gates as well, but Gates kind of followed Jobs' lead, we all know that. But these two, this Thomas Edison, Nikola Tesla kind of quality back and forth, the AC-DC fight, yes, they were entrepreneurs. They saw the future, they knew where their place was in it, but they took that opportunity to build what we now know today as just giants in this space. Apple's cash reserves are higher than our entire country's cash reserves. And they're expected to hit $1 trillion after iPhone X comes out. They have $1 trillion in cash reserve. One company started by two guys. It's amazing. Did they see the opportunities? Yes. Did they take that opportunity to devise products that would empty the normal person's bank account? Yes. So were they con men? Maybe. But they did catapult this space forward. And there's no reason that there should be any kind of hatred about what they've done. It's how we've used it, how we've taken this iPhone, this internet connection, and maybe not used it for everything it was possible to be used. We truly became capitalists. one of the great memes that I had reposted, and a friend of mine said that this is absolutely true. This generation has a device in their hands which enables them to see the collective knowledge of every other generation. And 90% of the time they use it for cat videos or rainbow vomit on Snapchat. So if you're going to discuss who the evil force here was, you have to rethink that and see who is the opportunist, who's the entrepreneur, who is the one misusing this. It's provided for you. The world's libraries are available, statistics, facts, books, publishing, everything you could think of. How is this generation using it, or were they kind of forced to use it only to buy as opposed to learn? And that's one of the real questions in this whole perception of veal. Veal, the animal, is stuck in that cage. Veal, the human, is really a little bit more free range than the animal version. Let's see where we are.
Do you think that, just to piggyback on this, jump off script real quick.
Yeah.
Do you think that the human veal is really free range?
That's
or is
the next part.
Is the human cage themselves?
They are caged themselves, but with this device, you have the ability to break out of that cage. And you're not using it.
Is that because
so that's the pressure of the herd.
Is that the, okay.
Let me go back. Let me start with that a little bit.
Okay, and then you want to, let's just do that again.
Okay, and the killer app, right? They do tie together. Let me tie them together. You'll see it.
That tie.
Okay. The term I just used, human veal versus veal the animal, veal the animal being caged. They're caged by the rancher. They're caged by the person wanting to chop them up and sell them, and that's what happens. Sorry. The human veal that I use the analogy towards, the question is, are they really free range? Do they have the ability to just break out and do what they want? They do. They can. The pressure of the herd and the herd mentality keeps them in that space. So there's kind of an invisible cage wrapped around them. The point I like to try and make is to make that transition from cage to free takes a tool. And you do have that tool. You can publish, you can write, you can take pictures, you can make movies, you can build sites, apps, games. You can do anything you want to break out of the cage, to go forward, but they choose to stay in it because they want to be part of this herd. And that to me comes from the factor that they didn't get the nurturing they needed early on in life. The term killer app comes up with any new computer device. The only reason the personal computer became in the home was the killer app of word processing. Kids could write their papers, parents could do their finances, they could bring home work. So that Microsoft Office-like suite of Lotus Notes or whatever it was made the killer app. Now as you move down the progression into the industry of desktop publishing, electronic publishing, graphics, music, the killer apps were things like Photoshop, Illustrator, Logic, Pro Tools. That's what made the move from home computer fun around the house to accepted industry standard to required skill set. The killer app for the internet are these kids. They're the missing piece. They're the piece that made this 100% worthwhile to get invested in. The reason why Zuckerberg put up Facebook, one of the reasons, is that he said he wants to replicate the college experience online. And that's a tremendous feat. But without those college kids looking at it online, that would have been just another great idea that never came through. Like any part of technology, without that main component, the killer app, the application of this hardware, it never would have went anywhere. So these young people and their involvement and their absorption and these multiple pieces coming together of the double income necessity, the out-of-house daycare, the needing to communicate with friends that they maybe saw at daycare that they can't get to because the parents are too tired to drive them, the arranging the play dates. This device that allowed them to communicate with friends that they wanted to speak to was the killer app, this desire. You pull all of these pieces together and you truly have the perfect consumer or consumable that made this platform truly work. Good answer? That was pretty good. Yeah, I tied it back together.
Killer app. It's been it a killer. I did that.
Yeah, the product.
So about Stimmen and the Herd in reference to Veal Theory. And then what is the product time and screen?
Hold on. For any marketplace to exist, for any economy to exist, yes, there has to be a consumer, but there has to be some form of monetary exchange. There has to be some form of currency. And the question comes up in the valuations of these currencies and these new platforms, what is their currency? The currency is time on a screen, eyeballs. A user opposite that computer screen interacting, spending their valuable time, that is what creates the currency. Many times in class I talk to students about social commerce and they always look at me like, what is social commerce? Social commerce is the amount of time and the amount of eyeballs that are on a platform. The more users, the higher the valuation. The more time those users buy anything on that platform, that valuation goes up. If you want to look at the equation of valuation, all you have to do is look at the user base times the typical amount of money generated, whether it's in advertising dollars or actually purchased items or analytics that come out of the back end. You times those two numbers and the equal is the valuation of the company. Now, one of the people I tremendously respect is Thomas Friedman. He's gotten a little full of himself, and if I was Thomas Friedman, I'd be 10 times worse. His wonderful books, The World is Flat, talking about how this these series of 10 flatteners have taken the world and made it a direct line. They're brilliant. I don't have to tell anyone that. I certainly don't have to tell him that. The thing I love about him is the way he takes it, digests it, and puts out the next book. And the next book's title is Thank You for Being Late, about how for some godforsaken reason, these devices that were meant to save us time have done nothing but eat up all of our time. And that's what I'm saying to you as the currency. Time on a screen, eyeballs, that's the currency. And we are, these young people are so absorbed, so incredibly absorbed with walking around, and I call it, because Jim Carrey of all people called it this, the zombie apocalypse. They walk around staring into their phone. Sometimes, obviously, you've seen the videos, maybe true, maybe not, of walking into walls, off curbs, into puddles, off docks, whatever it is. But that time right here is everything to them. And that's the currency. And Friedman's title of, first of all, The World is Flat, is brilliant. And secondly, Thank You for Being Late. Trying to make sure they prioritize life. Now, the other word that's thrown around today, insanely, is mindfulness. I'm too mindful. Friends of mine tell me, does your brain ever shut down? Did you not ever notice something? I had someone yell at me once, who's a friend of mine, that said, I have to make sure I watch out what I tell you, because you forget nothing. You are aware of everything. They call it hyper-observant. It's pattern recognition. I'm fortunate. That's one of the things I got. But seeing what I see on a daily basis and the patterns I see, I'm going to start hanging out with Temple Grandin. It's amazing the amount of currency passing through these little devices today. I'm going to get more sugar.
Do you want to leave now or do you want to keep going?
No, I'm just joking.
Screen time, eyeballs, FFF.
Physical and mental effects.
Where are we on? What page?
107.
Oh,
92, excuse me.
Oh, did that? Yeah. What is the physical? Yep. What is the physical and mental effects of too much screen time on a young child?
Okay. In putting together the research for this study with Veal, Breeding a New Consumer Class, I talked to a few friends of mine who are psychologists, who are therapists as well. And the discussion went into the amount of time this generation is spending on screen and the effects. And neurotransmitters come into play in the brain, obviously. The factor of never having to really look something up, this concept of not holding on to facts and accruing a knowledge base, because their mentality is, I'll just look it up again. I want to feel that mentality comes out of being born into a generation where they're in a candy store and the supply of candy never ends. It's like a really evil Willy Wonka, not that he wasn't, but a really evil Willy Wonka. Every time you take a Wonka bar, another one pops in. You don't have to worry if it's going to be there tomorrow. So the concept of worry, did I retain that fact? There's no consequence. If I didn't work as hard at soccer, after school activities, I'm still going to get a trophy. If I go to look something up and I forget it, I'll just look it up again when you ask me. The problem with that is stored memory, referring to memory, learning how to memorize and hold on to it, not as total educational structure, but understanding linkages between different memories, does help the brain form and does create a behavior that helps you separate knowledge. I would imagine there has to be some form of physiological structure going on. Anytime you use the brain to do something, you create neurotransmitters, you create synapses, you create a form of memory, a muscle memory, a body memory, and that has to build some kind of cognitive thought. Without that, I believe we're becoming more and more just responsive and not structural. And Veal, by nature, have no life outside of that cage and the next food and the next meal and the next bottle of whatever it is, milk or cream. So that's why, again, the analogy works so well. Because they're not thinking about tomorrow. Because tomorrow, if I need that fact, I'll just hit it up on Google again. So there's no concept of storing that knowledge base, referring to it, and that's how you develop critical thinking. And that's one of the major problems to me with this whole entire process. Okay, hold on. I don't want to do, hold on, I don't want to do 108 right now. Okay. I'm going to cut it and I'm going to push it. I'm going to push it in between 119 and 120. Okay, just so you know.
Okay. So we're going to
I don't know why I wrote that in the book. I think I was just trying to reiterate the problems that are possible. Do you know what I mean? Hold on. Right? The evilness of it. You get my point?
Yeah.
And it was in a bad spot, so.
So to describe in detail, you sold off pieces, part of it.
Yeah, hold on one second. Okay, let's do that.
Are you good?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Getting there.
Oh.
Triple digits now.
Right here. You know what I'm talking about? Like this. In the immortal words of the Little Rascals, we's freewheeling now, Spanky. Okay.
Describe in detail the sold off in pieces part of the veil theory.
Okay. Overall, the veil theory has been born, separated from the herd, brought to a small space, stimulated in a desirable fashion, and then once at prime, sold off in pieces to be consumed or to consume. And the sold off in pieces place gets people really nervous. I think it gives this image of chopping up children. And that's horrible, it really is. But what I'm talking about is chopping up their minds and kind of their souls as well. When you spend time on a computer, when you spend time in a social network, when you spend time on your phone endlessly, every moment you're there, and we talked about this before, every moment of time you spend there, generates revenue, not for you though. It generates revenue for whatever social media platform you're on, whatever internet service you're using, whatever browser you're using. So that's the part in which you're being consumed. Okay, you're being chewed up because your life is time. It's the only commodity you can never, ever get again. You can be rich and you can be poor. You can be fat and you can be thin. You can be handsome and you can be ugly. But the one thing you can never get back is time. And that commodity is worth everything. So that's the part that's being consumed. The amount of time on a screen is directly equal to the valuation of any of these social media or browser platforms. The only reason any of these things are worth money, Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter, even LinkedIn, the only reason they're worth any money is because of the amount of users and the time they spend. Advertisers use that to judge whether or not the ad rates are proper. The analytics put out are used to judge whether or not the products are moving to the right demographic. So this entire thought of consuming and being consumed is kind of like a snake eating its own tail. The more time or the more content that you consume online, the time you spend to read and do memes and reply and like, that is how you get consumed, because it's consuming up all of your free time. So taking that veal analogy and theory again, at the end of the day, each piece of the veal is kind of diced and sliced off, and that's the reason for the image I present, with a little price tag for Facebook, for Twitter, for Instagram, for Snapchat, for Google, for YouTube. They have different numbers because each one of those platforms has a different valuation based on users and also based on the worth of their analytics and information they present to the clients who advertise on them. So how are they consumed? How does it consume? Using your time, your valuable, irreplaceable commodity of the time of your day in life. Good explanation. No?
I'd give you a participation trophy. But
thank you.
You told me you don't like them.
All right, so I did do 110.
Yeah.
Okay, this is the last part that's fun.
How do virtual stars?
Yeah, virtual stars. How are your time and attention? Okay. Yeah, I got that. Okay, now I know what I'm going to use for 115. Okay, wow, we're really crazy ass close, dude.
And then 120, we're going to talk a little bit about it.
Yeah,
we'll
yeah,
right,
good move. Starting with virtual stars, right?
Yep. How do virtual stars and commodities shape and influence the culture and economy?
When I asked a bunch of my students, what are you going to do at the end of college? What's your plan? No one ever asked me that. And I think because they figured I didn't have one or I was lucky to get through. But when I asked these young people, what are you going to do after college? They literally said to me, Kim Kardashian. They literally said, realistically, not just to annoy me, they literally said Kim Kardashian. They literally said Cutie Pie, Logan Paul. That's like saying, at the end of your high school career back in the 70s or 60s, what are you going to do? I'm going to become John Lennon, I'm going to become Paul McCartney, and that's possible for 0.001%. But this answer that I'm getting today is way bigger than the 0.0001%. I use the term that years ago 80% were kind of workable, doable, there, going forward, and 20% were the oddities that didn't kind of work the same way. That now has switched. 80% are the ones saying, I'm doing this, that, and I understand why. Because they're seeing the Justin Biebers who did 3 YouTube videos and all of a sudden got kind of stardom thrust upon them. They're seeing Cutie Pie and Logan Paul and these other people who are promoting different forms of maybe cosmetics or any brand product. And they're thinking, I could do that. I look like them, I act like them. It's just a bigger ratio of American Bandstand. And in this case, they really do like the beat, and they really think they can dance to it. The problem is no one wants to hear that song. And that song will be gone in 15 seconds. The other reasoning behind it is, let's take a look at 2008, and let's take a look at 2001. Both dates that I keep putting out there, 9/11 and 08, when the financial collapse. On 9/11, the fear of life, oh Lordy, pulled those families closer, but made the guilt bigger if you had to leave that kid again. But it also made this generation traumatized in the sense of fragility and hopelessness of life. 08, a lot of the parents lost their retirement, lost their savings, lost the kids' college funds in this financial collapse. So again, you had this trauma, and again, you had this no belief in the future. So if you're starting to believe that I may die from some horrible event, or if you're starting to believe that no matter how hard my dad or mom worked, the money's all gone, you're not going to look down traditional routes. You're not going to look down the road at the typical American dream. You're not going to look down that road. You're going to say, okay, who else is grabbing what they want and running? Who else is an instant celebrity? Look at Kimye. They do whatever they want. They sell, they whatever. But you can't blame them. You can't blame them. When the tragedy of 9/11 happened, when numerous events over the course of the last 16 years has proved again and again the possibility of that happening is higher and higher, when the financial collapse happened and these people worked 60, 70 hours a week for 18 years, 20 years to get that college fund ready, and then overnight it's gone, when the value of their house went underwater within 2 days, all of that hard work, all of that money, all of that effort gone. You really can't blame a generation for thinking, in the immortal words of P.T. Barnum, there's a sucker born every minute. Or the great words of Bruce Springsteen, my hero, there are winners and losers, and don't get caught on the wrong side of that line. And that that's reflected in the mentality today. You can't blame them.
Oh, Brucey.
That's right. Oh, Brucey.
How's your time, attention, and structure?
Yeah. I'm not in love with that, David. How are your time? Let me go to do social networks. All right. How much are the ranchers making while your young ones are busy? Yep. Okay. What is the real price? Okay. Hold on. That line now goes below what is the real price of the so-called convenience. How is your time being structured? Am I right? We're at 118, I think. 115?
115.
I look at 119, right?
Yeah.
Do social networks hurt more than they help? How much money are the ranchers making while your young ones are doing?
That's a question.
What is the real price of the so-called convenience, and how is your time structured? How is your time and attention being structured? Okay, so those go together well. Okay. For the last 30 years, I've been involved in the evolution of online. I was fortunate in the 80s to work for a brilliant person at McGraw-Hill Education. I loved my job. Who saw the future and saw that I was kind of a part of it. And through the wonderful nurturing of my good friend, Cesar Del Valle, I was put into this space and really nurtured through his abilities and his help, and I always tell him I owe my life right now to meeting you. And Sybil Parker, my editor, at the time saying, okay, you've got a good brain, let's try you. Yes, I responded. Yes, I did well from it. But I do love what is possible. The question is, you know, are we using our superpowers for good? And again, I get back to this 80-20 ratio. Used to be that 20% of television and radio and movies was not good. 80% was really okay. That number's flipped. 20% is really okay. A good friend of mine just said to me yesterday, I have to fight through 15 ads and scrollables and pop-ups just to read The Atlantic or New York Times or some quality content. And that's insane. Social media platforms are the same way. When they started, a friend of mine said, there will be no advertising on these. And he was like, God, 30 years younger than me, 20 years younger than me. And I looked at him like, are you insane? That's the only reason they're doing this, is so that they can get you used to it and then charge you. That's basically the drug dealer scenario, right? That's the business plan of every drug dealer during the 70s. The first hit is free. And the same thing is true with social media. They get everybody into one space, and then they start charging them to be in that space. So are they helping? They could do so much more. One of the things I look towards is open access for education. Again, Schumpeter's model here. It's going to blow up education, and it already has. The concern is peer review. The concern is the quality. And this gets back all the way to when anything new is invented, how we guarantee that what will be there will be quality. You take from Book of Kells, the oldest illuminated manuscript, and then you go to magazines where they're so easily replicated. You can see the quality's been lost. But the beauty of this space right now, to change that equation, almost has no cost factor associated. Almost there's nothing stopping it besides the individual. Has it hurt more than it's helped? In the early stages, yes, and that's always the case. There were more jobs lost. There were more trouble when the early days of cars or any new invention. Now we have to see how this plays out. Remember, the web is only 25 years old. 93 is when Sir Tim Berners-Lee constructed the first browser called World Wide Web. This year coming up will be 25 years. We have to give it a little bit more time to see how well this generation that was really made to be chewed up in this space turns it on its head and turns it to something worthwhile.
All right.
Stifling a naggy cough. Oh, I hit future. Look at that.
So we are 120 now, right?
Yeah.
Alright. So what Rich had asked for 120 is
Dead.
That you both ask these questions and then answer them.
Good.
Right? So just do one, we do one at a time,
yeah,
until we get to the end of 120. And then it's like we get close to the end, right?
We are at the end.
So what is 125 is the end?
Wait a minute. Yeah.
Right, something like that.
Yeah, this is over here. Okay, this scares me right now. Okay, so 120 is the abuse of technologies can go on forever.
Yep.
Most people say it's up to the user, but is it really? Yes, okay. If the only food in the supermarket kills, then is it up to you to create the farm? Yes and no, okay. Can you, I'm gonna just do some rearranging here.
Yep.
Can you trust in the political and societal mechanisms like the FDA? You really could have left it as should, I guess, right? David, do me a favor.
What?
Is there, he's probably, would you look in that fridge to see if there's a can of club soda? Because I don't have any singles anymore. And this is starting to like burn. It's right underneath that corner.
If it's just seltzer, is that okay?
Yeah, don't be a dick. Watch.
Nah,
last time you tripped on the thing.
Tonic water, we're okay. Yeah,
you
got a shiz ton.
No. You do?
It is.
Yeah, give me a club soda.
Well, there's three.
Fuck. Yeah, I'll buy him one.
Okay.
I'm dying for that fucking eggplant rotini. I can't tell you how bad.
I'm afraid you wouldn't encourage us a lot. Bring me off.
Soda. I really do.
It's weird. I don't like the flavored ones though.
I'm not a big fan.
I need the regular.
This right here, right?
Yeah. It's cool. But it's no, I don't drink it because I don't want. It's like a gateway drug back to
soda.
First you go diet, and then you're right back to the.
I was joking with somebody, something, and I said, "Oh, I see at the bottom he wrote that."
Well, I wrote that.
Oh, okay. I was saying once you go Pat, you never go back. Because the kids, the honors student, this honors student, this really cute girl, Shelby, really nice person, very smart. Just a good kid. She goes, I kept asking what classes you're teaching next, what you're teaching next. And I go, is that because just I'm an easy dope to work with? She goes, no, because I really enjoy the way you teach. I go, okay. So joking around, I go, I know, once you go Pat, you never go back. And they were like, oh my God, that's horrible. But it was fine. I tell you the truth, I really loved that the other day with how do you add depth? Oh my God, that was hysterical. I was like, well, I like to read.
Like, you're no longer allowed to ask questions.
Yeah, I have to do them, right?
What? No. I mean, to that guy with the depth. So
okay.
I wish it was like China. Okay. You're like,
yeah, he's out. Exactly.
Come on.
And I wanted to say, oh, so you meant the pumpkin.
And
okay.
All right, so yeah, so just read the question and then give us an answer.
Okay, we're good. I'm in the same spot.
Okay.
Many people believe the abusive use of technologies can go on forever. And the question is it up to the user? Is it up to the people who use them? And I really do believe it is. I believe the whole nature behind the internet is the power comes back to the user. Yeah, it is a rigged game, as all things are, but the user, just don't use it. You see how quickly apps die. That great commercial, the two messengers, and the ad executives are behind them, and they're in the elevator. Are you on Woo Woo? Oh yeah, Woo Woo's the deal. The executives run in the office and say, get off of everything else. We need to devise a plan for Woo Woo. That's a new platform. 20 minutes later, they get back on the elevator. The bike messengers come on. They go, you still on Woo Woo? Now I'm off Woo Woo. And then they're frantic. So yeah, the people do actually have the power to create the structure. The metaphor for creating that structure is, if the only food available to eat is food that will kill you, is it up to the user, the people, to create their own form? Yeah, it is. Again, my father taught me one thing in life. You have two hands, you have two eyes, you got two feet. Everything is on you. But yes, this is a difficult thing to do, to turn things around. But you really don't have a choice. Should you trust somewhat in the elected officials? You can't even say that with a straight face today. Should you trust in the people you've elected to be your public servants to make sure that the internet is used properly, that there are funds available for inner city schools, that the digital divide doesn't get too wide? I don't think you can trust anyone anymore on that. It's the scary part. During these terrible hurricanes that hit recently, the news channels are talking about the amazing individual efforts to help and save people in the neighborhoods. And yeah, but the reason I give 30% of my income to someone, the government, is that those services should be readily available when a catastrophe strikes. So the concept of paying for 60 years and hearing it turned back as entitlement as opposed to my money in a situation of a hurricane, in the situation of internet safety, in the situation of access to the internet, thinking that that's something you have to do on your own is insane. Protecting your children, of course you do. You have to have common sense and see what they're saying. But the fact that you should make sure these companies don't abuse, that's pure insanity.
Hold on. Okay. I'm going to jump to 122. Should I be answering and asking these as well?
This whole list up until so.
Okay,
up
to the end.
Do so.
Okay. No problem.
One of the shows I used to love, and I personally love Aaron Sorkin's writing. I think he's amazing. One of the shows I loved that I was recent of his was The Newsroom. And it started out with this amazing 3 minutes. And that's Sorkin. Shock and awe. He hits you hard first. And the amazing first 3 minutes was this kind of Jay Leno-like newscaster where he just want to make everybody happy kind of attitude. This college professor, being a real way that college professors can be, held him to a point when a young co-ed at a town hall environment asked him, is America the greatest country? Why is it? And the one person on the panel said freedom, the other one said liberty, and it cut to Will McAvoy, Jeff Daniels. And he was playing around saying, yes, freedom, liberty. And the moderator said, I'm holding you to a real answer. And he snapped. And he said, it's not. It used to be. And he told about all the amazing things we did in the second half of the 20th century. He's right. So today, with things like the DMCA, net neutrality, ISPs getting your viewing history, your browsing history, these are things we need to fight for. As he said, we used to make great things. We fought against polio. We fought against disease. We fought against dictatorships. Now all we have to do is come together and to fight. We've seen it with the Women's March. We've seen 700,000 women in Los Angeles alone marching because they didn't like what was going on. You saw it in the 60s. Now it's a bigger critical mass in the sense that the economy today is just starting online. We're nowhere near the saturation of jobs online that are going to happen once my kids' kids need jobs. And not just jobs, but life. The hacking that's going on today, the lack of cybersecurity, the preying on the individuals, the abuse of private information. If we don't fight for this now, it's like any disease. If you don't go to the doctor early, if you don't nip it in the bud, Andy, if you don't stop this in the earliest stages, it will permeate, become the way of life, and Orwell will be right. Now is the time to stop this, not 20 years from now. Is America the greatest country in the world? Could be. Used to be. It's in the hands of these people to reclaim that.
And Yosemite.
Yeah, what is that from?
It's the end of it. He goes, what makes America great? I don't know. Yosemite?
Yeah, I didn't. Oh, Yosemite the park.
Yeah, that's because.
Oh.
Yeah.
I wasn't. Oh, that's why he says
yeah.
Yosemite.
Yeah, I don't know. Yosemite? Because it's. Just in case you wander into a voting booth.
Because you are the worst period generation period ever period.
So,
did you like the show?
No, I just watched that 2 minute episode. And
that fucking was amazing, right?
Yeah. I never went further than
oh,
that.
You have to, David.
Yeah, it's good.
It's on HBO. You have HBO Go now.
Yeah.
You can steal it somewhere, I'm sure. It's amazing. It's amazing. Okay.
Right,
so we're at Iceland.
Is it where we go?
Oh no.
Grid becomes violent.
Yeah. Okay. Here's what I'm gonna do. Okay. Predatory lending gone unchecked, plain and simple. Okay. I'm going to move that to Iceland because it's the same thing.
Where are we on?
122.
Sorry.
I'm taking the last line
uh-huh.
and putting it above Iceland because it's what happened in Iceland, but they paid for it.
Okay.
Okay. Ready? Okay.
Yep.
In 2008, 2007, 2008, and 2009, we suffered a tremendous financial crisis based on housing being underwater, underneath the mortgage values, about how lenders were leading borrowers to believe that the value in the house was so much higher, so they would take out so much bigger of a mortgage and use the equity. This was predatory lending. This was an abusive financial system. Then they then bundled those bad loans with other assets, not as toxic, but close, and sold them to international investors. One of the groups that got hurt by this, not that they were innocent, they were trying to buy a pig and a poke, something that never would work, was Iceland. They went from this fishing economy to where they became incredible financial advisors overnight. And that country went right down to bankruptcy as well. Greece, Spain, many were teetering. The difference with Iceland is, in our country, we decided these people were too big to fail. And the saying became, but not too big to jail. We bailed out every one of these major banks. Paulson, Bush, Obama. Remember, 08. The end of 8 years of Bush, the beginning of 8 years of Obama. Right at that point in time is when everything fell apart. Actually, within the transition. And my belief is because they knew the scam wouldn't work anymore. There was a new sheriff in town. In Iceland's case, it's got his butt stuck in the door on the way out. The difference in Iceland, Every single one of those bank presidents stood trial. Every single one of those financial heads stood trial. And some, many, went to jail. There were consequences in Iceland. Yes, it is 1/100th the size of our country. It is probably smaller than that. But there were consequences. I think because it was manageable, because of size, because of lower population, it was easier to do. But it's something that should be noted, that no institution, if it has harmed this many people, should ever be seen as too big to jail. And the internet, the web platforms inspire that fear again. And you've seen it recently in the news with the lawyers from Google and Facebook sitting there in the Senate asking how they did not know that the ads were being paid for by Russian operatives, because the checks were being paid in rubles. And how could the ads in our for our 2016 election being paid by Russian sources not be noticed? So this internet structure is so large, not even including the dark net, that many things can happen here and get out of control quickly, to use a great term, going viral way too easily, but with much greater harm, more harm than ever known, and definitely closer to a real virus. Okay, hold on, why is there, oh. Okay, so now it's how do we help, right?
Where are we at, 22?
Yeah, no, I'm at 24, we just did 22, 23.
Yeah, you're right.
So we're at 24, what can you do to prevent?
All this from happening.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
I don't want to use the quality and character, well, maybe. Okay, this is really a different one. Okay, so 24, what can you do to prevent this? How can you educate yourself? And, okay, yeah, maybe how many qualities and characteristics of this new Gen I are part of your DNA? Okay. Ready? At the end of the day, the question is, how can we stop this from happening again? Whether it's the financial collapse, the abuse of this new technology, the abuse of our children, the abuse of our lives and time. Well, you really can't stop it. You can't stop it from happening. What you can do is see that when it does happen, you don't stand in its way. Can you become more of this world? Yes. Anytime something new comes about, there's going to be multiple destructions. Know that it's coming, like a tsunami, like a series of wind. Understand that it's coming at you and your home and your family, and how to prepare properly. And the easiest way to prepare properly is to monitor time. And one of my colleagues, who I truly respect, calls it a digital diet. And it's not easy. It's not easy, as for the reasons we discussed. You're at the end of a 60-hour week, the both of you. You're exhausted. You just want to be able to make sure everything is generally okay and to do as best you can. It's tough to maintain and watch that diet without the time that you can dedicate to those kids. I think as we go through this process of the rebirth again of this platform, of social media, of learning online, of anything that has to do with the transition from analog to digital, the question is it internal to you as parents to be in this space? I think once you go through something, you learn, and it's muscle memory, it's just part of your process, so you're going to adapt, especially if it has anything to do with your loved ones. You're going to adapt and change. Are you part of that DNA? Nowhere near what your children are. I'm 62 this year. Every one of my students looks at me and says, why do you even know about this stuff? And some get offended that I do, because it's their space. I am an interloper, albeit I'm one of the earliest guys around this space who probably helped create a lot of it. But it's not part of my DNA in their eyes. Our job, your job, is to make it part of your DNA and change it for the better. Good?
Good.
Okay. I did do the next four things, you know what I mean?
Banking, community.
Yeah, let's go to, okay. How to become easier, cheaper. Hold on. Is this G8 is kind of old, because we did talk about it in the last time, but I do want to, hold on. This is going to be jumped. All right, you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to throw G, I'm going to make this guy, ask yourself, 126. Ask yourself if the way you do these things has changed. I'm going to just change it to ask yourself, in my mind, if these will be here. These actions or needs or jobs, you know what I mean? Will be here. Wow, I'm tired. Are you tired?
Are you getting there?
Yeah, right?
We're at the end,
baby.
Yeah.
Got to push the energy level up. And this is where I talk about G8. Okay. So, hold the phone, Chuck. This part I can do. I do so many times I could pass out. Okay. Okay. In the next 20 years, my belief is going to be that what we used to do in an analog, banking, education, purchasing, even arranging for travel or retirement or anything that we did in an analog way is going to change. It's going to become obviously digital. We're seeing it today more than ever before. We can make plans for a trip, plan our retirement, go to the bank, read our favorite columnists, watch our favorite TV shows, even from our childhoods. We don't even have to move. We don't have to get off the couch at any point in time. I was joking around with a student that if I ever put a GoPro on my head to watch my actions, it would just be 8 hours of the television set, and every now and then my hand would come up with chips into camera frame. So I'm kind of there already, and I think my health reflects it at times. The question is, is this going to be the driving force forever behind this economy? And is this economy really being shaped this way, and what can we do? I always have to refer back to economic summits like G8 and G20. G8, eight countries get together to discuss the future economics of the planet in certain areas. G20, larger group of countries come together and discuss how the economics and structure are going to be. That's what they do. That's how it's run. Things are not done in a week-by-week basis. This isn't a mom-and-pop candy store where you got to figure out, oh, is Easter coming up? Or is a holiday coming up? What can I order? These things are done over 10, 15, 20-year plans. Yes, they shift. But primarily, that's how wars come around. Wars come around because certain groups are not included in those 20-year plans. You decide that you're going to go into a country, take its natural resources, fight them because you want to control that market space. This is the old mafia move where Don Vito moves in on the Rosato brothers. It's the same thing. That wonderful scene where Hyman Roth is having his birthday and he's slicing the cake and giving out pieces to each one of the family members in his crime family. That's exactly what G8 and G20 is. The question is, in the next 20 years, where do you and your family fit in to that party? Are you going to get a slice of that cake? Is your child's future predetermined in that space? Are what they doing on a daily basis helpful, hurtful? What is going on? And that's what the goal of this entire perception of veal. How not to be it, how to recognize when you are being it, how to recognize the virtues in this space, the pitfalls, and how to make sure that you help you, your family, maybe others, maneuver through this space to the best possible outcome. Thank you for your time.
That ends the questions?
Yes, ma'am, and we're out.
Before you go, I mean, one more for you.
Sure, good, babe.
What would you tell your future grandchild who graduated high school? What advice would you give them? So it's, again, it's predicting a little bit in the future.
Yeah.
What advice would you give your future grandchild after graduating high school?
So 30 years, just by the time I...
Yeah.
To be really honest with you, like, can we take this serious for a second? If I had to project my advice for my future family members, grandchildren, when they were ready to truly come into society as a contributing part, they're graduating school or college or high school or whatever, what would I tell them as advice? What would I give them as advice? What would I say to them? One of the strongest principles that my parents instilled in me and all immigrants and all first-gen families was education. Learn as much as you can. The other thing I would tell them is never waste time. A firm believer in the biggest commodity in the world is time. Also, take time to become something. But once you're there, don't waste any. Learn every day. Don't waste a second. Don't let anything abuse you, whether it's your time in an environment where it's only going to someone else's benefit and not yours. Be kind, be generous to your family. Be kind, be generous to your family. Many mistakes people make, they abuse their family but treat someone else kinder. And they always say, you always hurt the ones you love. Well, if you're very selfish with your time in this space, which is what we're seeing today with this zombie apocalypse, they almost have no time for the people who have helped make them who they are and the life they enjoy today, because they want to impress someone on a screen who doesn't care about them. That's the control that this platform has. So as you immerse yourself into this space, always remember the people on the other side of the screen are not the important people. The people standing next to you are. And they're the ones that are going to support you. Should you embrace this technology, you're not going to have a choice. Should you embrace being a part of building this? Yeah. If that's what you enjoy doing. If it's not what you enjoy doing, good luck. It's going to be a very different world. Find what you can do and what your niche is. Stay there and just work extremely hard. The other point I'd like to make, and something I never believed until I got too old, there's nothing wrong with being the smartest person in the room. If you find yourself to be the smartest person in the room, get out of that room. Find another one where you can learn something. Because if you're the smartest person in the room, you're wasting that time. Go work harder and find a room where you can learn forever, and then move to the next one. Times move forward, things change. Static doesn't work. The those days are over. And best of luck. Good?
Yep. All right.
We got enough.